Hi, welcome to One People, One World. My name is Rabbi Yaakov Cohen. I'm here with Chaim Goldstein. Shalom, Chaim. How are you? How are you?
Very well, thanks.
Chaim, please tell us about yourself and where you're from and so on.
I'm a college student in Philadelphia.
Right.
And I'm currently in Crown Heights. I was here for the week studying at Yeshiva, Hadar Torah. It's my first Yeshiva experience, and it's been very, very rewarding so far. I've definitely enjoyed my time here.
Okay, what was your experience about Yeshiva? Going, studying one-on-one with people?
Studying one-on-one, we did a little chavrusa, one-on-one studying, but also learning Gemara, learning Chumash, learning Law at a very basic introductory level, which I felt very comfortable with, and I definitely got a lot out of it.
Okay, that's great. So you're from Philly?
I am from Philly, yes.
You're going to the University of Philly. And you want to tell, what are you studying over there?
I'm studying civil engineering. I'm currently a senior at Temple University.
Okay, that's in Philly.
Yes.
So you want to tell us about your path?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. I've come a long way to be here at Yeshiva in Crown Heights this week. I was raised as a Reformed Jew.
Okay.
And I grew up in a community where I had a very big struggle connecting with Hashem. I didn't really know how, and I just don't believe I was really taught the right way. Looking back at the teachings I had as a child in Hebrew school, both prior to and following Bar Mitzvah, I was taught a lot of things that I've since then have turned around, and I have interpreted other ways. For example, I was taught things like keeping kosher is outdated, there's no reason for it anymore. And people who don't drive their cars on Saturdays are crazy, there's no reason to. You know, God's not going to strike you down if you drive your car or turn on a light switch. And this is what I was raised to believe, and I just struggle with this connection of trying to figure out how I can speak to God.
Right.
And I would try to talk to God in my own personal way, I just didn't really know how. I would sometimes stay up late at night just praying, but not the type of praying where you open up a siddur and read barachas and prayers from there. It was more just like just having a conversation with you is the same way I'd be talking to Hashem. I didn't really know how else to do it, and my family tried to help me. My father was supportive of my Jewish education. Unfortunately, my mother wasn't there supportive as much as I'd wanted her to be. But since then, I've been able to find on my own the way to connect with Hashem. And I've come a long way. Once I got into college, I was first exposed to Chabad. And I was
Rabbi
Baruch Kantor. Yes. Yes, great man. He's definitely helped me out. And I've since started keeping Shabbos, keeping kosher. But, of course, this didn't happen overnight. This was probably about a year and a half ago. I was dating a Muslim girl.
Dating a Muslim girl, yes.
Yeah, really. That's how my path to kosher started, and she doesn't eat pork. So I said, you know what? I'm not going to eat pork either. And then I decided, maybe a week after we're dating, I'm going to try keeping kosher for a week. Keeping kosher in the way just not mixing milk and meat, no pork, no shellfish. I think I can do it. Well, she takes me out to birthday dinner, and we go to Red Lobster. So, you can see it was a little difficult from starting off that way. But, of course, that relationship kind of fuzzled shortly after that had taken place, and I had gone on to learn more about Judaism, and I'd learned more about why we keep kosher, and I'd started feeling better inside of myself. And I was able to start keep kosher on my own at home, and start keeping Shabbos as well. And it really stemmed from there, and now I've gone into some Jewish learning, some real one-on-one Jewish learnings with rabbis, and also learning in yeshiva.
So you find learning Torah is the best, it fills you up.
Definitely fills me up.
It gives you something to...
It does. It answers the questions I've always had. I never really understood certain concepts in Judaism, but learning Torah kind of explains that in one way or another.
Right. When you're actually learning Torah, you're internalizing God, and you're having the most intimate relationship with God that's humanly possible.
Absolutely. And I look back at my upbringing, the Reformed Judaism I was brought up with, and I remember distinctly, I will never forget this, but we had a debate in class one day whether or not the Torah was written by God or whether it was written by wise old men. And here I am, a little kid, not even bar mitzvah age, I'm thinking to myself, how can we even debate that? Why would Judaism have existed for thousands of years? Why would we be studying these old texts if they were written by wise old men? Why would it still be around today? And I was almost offended that my teacher at the time would even bring that up and have a conversation about it in class.
And you've obviously went to... Tell us about... You were telling us the story about the tefillin, about how you also put on tefillin now.
Yes, I started putting on tefillin lately. And it is... It's not easy to get tefillin. It's very expensive. You have to find a... a reliable sulfur to get it from, and I had trouble getting it for a while. I had been speaking to rabbis for the past several months, how can I get to fill in? I don't know, I'll see what I can do, I'll call some people. I had applied for a scholarship or some type of financial assistance to get discounted to fill in, never heard back from them, and I was told, well, there's a program you can go through and get to fill in with a discount, but it's not really good quality, and I was just kind of going crazy because I want to put on tefillin every day. I really want to be able to connect with Hashem the way that all Jewish men do every morning, but I have to drive to a shul. Or I'd have to go chase down my rabbi or borrow from a friend. It's not always easy. I wasn't able to do it. So I had gone to the Ohel.
The Ohel is the resting place of the Babich Rebbe, right?
Yes.
In Queens, right?
Yeah, and I'd gone there just several days ago, right before Shabbos. And
this happened just now?
This happened
less than a week ago.
Two days ago. And I had written the Rebbe a letter, as is customary to do, write a letter, read it to him, and then throw it into his into his grave. And I wasn't very specific. I had basically said to him, please help me find a place in the Jewish community, please help me find my Jewish path. And lo and behold, I had finished up reading the letter, reading the Psalms as is customary, and I went back into the building in front of the OL, and I had spoken to the guy there. I said, there's a sign here. It says, if you don't have to fill in, let us know. I said, I don't have to fill in. You know, can you help me out? He says, would you like to buy the fill in? I said, I'd love to buy the fill in. I can't afford it, so if you can give me a discounted rate, or if you can refer me to someone. He goes, listen, if you need to fill in, we'll get you to fill in. I said, okay, well, I mean, how much would it cost me? I'd be willing to get it. I was like, if you want to fill in, we'll get you to fill in. So I go into this rabbi's office, I sit down with him, he says to me, so I tell him my story, I give him my information, and he says, would you put this on every day? I said, absolutely, 6 days a week I'd put it on. And he says, are you left-handed or right-handed? I said, I'm left-handed. He hands me a pair of tefillin, brand new. It was very beautiful, very moving. I almost teared up at just the thought that the Chabad Lubavitch movement would be so generous as to just donate a pair of tefillin like that. I'm eternally grateful for it, and I will absolutely 100% put on every single day.
So your journey is actually a very interesting journey. This is the second time you're in Crown Heights.
Second time in Crown Heights. I was here a little over a month ago for a student Shabbaton.
Right. How was that?
It was fun. I had a good time. Of course, I didn't really get a chance to study. It was more of a relaxed event aimed towards college students.
And now you've really managed.
Now I've really become part of the community. I've been here over a week now. Yes.
And one of the things, you've actually coming from a journey, you're actually looking at growing in spiritually and both physically in the Torah.
Definitely.
The Torah, this week's portion, is actually Shemos, which talks about the names. Each one of the children of Israel is counted. And the counting signifies something special. God counts it, and he counts it. Because every Jew has a special place. As it says, every Jew represents a letter in the Torah. And every letter is if one letter is missing, it renders the entire Torah non-kosher. So it's very precise and very for the fact that you're here. You want to tell us about you're coming from, you're also going through, you're actually going through conversion here?
Yes, that's one thing I would like to mention. As I was becoming more religious, I did this program on campus where I basically take a few classes And you get a stipend in the end. It was just studying. It was through a program, not Chabad affiliated. It was another Jewish movement.
Okay, 1 minute. You mentioned it.
Yes. And I had been learning with this rabbi in a class. It was a very informal setting. And when the program had completed, I wanted to be in touch with the rabbi. I said, you know, I would love to be able to start keeping Shabbos. I really want to keep kosher. I want to be more observant. So I sent him an email. I said, I would love to be able to start keeping Shabbos now. Can you find me a place to stay? I never heard from him. And I had called him and texted him, emailed him, never heard back. And I said, you know, what's going on here? Months had gone by. He kept ignoring me. And so I finally met up with him probably about 4 months later after the program had commenced. I said, you know, I'm trying to keep Shabbos. I hope you can give me a place to stay. And also, you know, I haven't received my stipend yet. He goes, well, I looked back at your application, and I saw that your mother wasn't Jewish. I said, yeah, that's true. And he says, well, I can't give you your stipend because you're not Jewish. And I was extremely hurt, extremely devastated, the fact that not only was I not eligible for it, he neglected to tell me, and also had just completely ignored me for months until I had chased him down. And it was very upsetting to me because I'd finally found a place in this, you know, Jewish community, and I was not even being accepted for who I was. Fortunately, my Chabad rabbi had spoken to me about this previously, about a month or so prior, and he says to me, I understand your mother's not Jewish, because
she never converted.
Right, she never converted. Her father was Jewish. Her mother was not. So my grandmother on my mother's side was not Jewish.
Which we go according to Jewish law, but it's according to the mother.
Right. And he said to me, I understand you were speaking how you want to marry a Jewish girl, and if that's great, but if you do want to marry a Jewish girl, then you should consider converting to Judaism. And was I upset? Yes. But I understood what he meant, and I still work with this rabbi. This is Baruch Cantor. I still work with him to this day. He's a very nice guy. And he's helped me through this path to conversion. And it's just been taking me a long time to kind of figure out, like, why is it that I'm not considered Jewish just because my mother's not? And I figured out it's pretty simple. It's nothing to do with halakha. It's the fact that I wasn't raised through the suffering of a Jewish mother. Kidding, of course.
Yeah.
But seriously, it has been a little more difficult for me. The word got out, long story short, that I wasn't Jewish. And people started treating me differently. I was being talked about. In my university, and also it spread to another university near the one I go. People are talking behind my back, and I hear negative things saying about me because my mother's not Jewish, and I didn't tell anyone, but like the word got out. And you know, it's been rough. It has been very difficult.
But, you know, the idea that non-Jews, you know, everyone has their role. So Jews and non-Jews, each one has one of the things that my organization promotes is the seven laws amongst non-Jews. The seven laws that are basically the seven principles, which are dear for non-Jews. We actually discourage conversion.
Right.
And the idea is that everyone could be, not everyone has to be Jewish. But you decided that you want to become Jewish.
I feel like I have a Jewish soul.
And you wanted.
I always have.
Right. And you wanted to pursue it.
Absolutely.
Well, the name like Chaim Goldstein. What's the English name?
Kyle
Goldstein.
Yes, pretty. Goldstein is pretty Jewish. And when I met the Beis Din for the first time, he says, Kyle Goldstein, you're looking at converting? That sounds pretty Jewish to me. I said, well, I told him the story.
And how's your mother about this and your father?
My father is somewhat understanding. I mean, he is Jewish. He was raised Jewish.
Raised conservative, both of that?
I believe he was raised Reformed.
Reformed, okay.
So he understands what I'm going through, and he seems to respect it. My mother, on the other hand, Baruch Hashem, I love her to death, but she just doesn't really seem to understand what I'm going through. Based on the way she was raised, unfortunately.
She was raised to.
She was really raised without a religion. She claims to have very strong belief in God, but does not believe in organized religion. And I think it stems back to her father, who was actually born and raised here in Brooklyn, but suffered a very abusive childhood for being Jewish. He was fired from his job for taking off on the High Holy Days. He was physically abused and ended up changing his name just to get rid of all signs of Yiddishkeit, all signs of his Judaism. And I think my mother was raised in that setting where she just doesn't think organized religion is necessary to have a connection with God. And I pray all the time to that.
It's important to work with your mother and to educate her. Not educate her, but, you know, to really give her understand where she's coming from.
Absolutely.
Not to, you know, you can't preach to her or anything like that, but, you know, you could inspire her, so to speak.
That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to really educate her. I'm not trying to get her to believe my beliefs, obviously. Yeah, I wouldn't do that. I just want her to understand.
And you have to respect her, you know, where she is.
Right. I respect my mother for what she does. I just wish she would understand where I'm coming from. And
eventually.
Yes.
Eventually she'll come around.
I pray every day that she understands the conversion I go through, that she understands why I need to convert, she understands why I'm becoming religious, why I don't answer my phone on Saturdays, why I don't mix milk and meat, for example, and I try to explain it to her, and I just don't think she understands, but I pray that...
Is your grandfather still alive?
My grandfather's no longer with us, no. And if he were alive, I feel like it would probably be even more difficult, because he probably would not so much approve of what I'm doing. Also, I don't know. Obviously, he's not here. I'm not sure.
But, so you're one of how many? Three brothers.
Three brothers, yes.
The oldest. You're taking the leading the way, so to speak, as an older brother.
I am. I am the oldest brother in my family. Yes.
And have you been to Israel as well?
I have not. I'm planning on going birthright soon. Okay. And I think it'll be a much more powerful experience now that I've become religious in the meantime. Back when I first heard about Birthright, I was far from religious at all. And I think it'd be a much different experience going there now, at this point in my life.
And you want to practice as a civil engineer, huh?
I do. I'm looking at, going into the transportation engineering world. That's really what my lifelong dream has been.
My dad's a civil engineer.
Oh, okay.
He worked for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers.
Okay.
And the Rebbe also.
The Rebbe was also
He was an engineer for the United States Army.
Oh, I knew he was an engineer for the Army, okay.
He worked for the U.S. Army in the Brooklyn Navy Yard.
Oh, okay, I didn't know that.
That goes back many moons ago. Many, many moons.
Right.
Now the Brooklyn Navy Yard is not much of a Navy.
Yes.
But once upon a time, it was a very big Navy Yard.
Yes.
Okay. And the Rebbe worked here, my father worked here, a lot of people worked here. It used to be one of the major, major shipyards in America back in World War II.
Okay.
It's right next to Williamsburg, actually, if you drive by.
Okay, I'm sure I've been by before.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm from Philly, so I'm not too familiar with this area.
Yeah. Anyways, work as a transportation. Okay, that's a very noble, getting people from one place to point A to
It's
to
very important, you know, people need to get from one place to another, and so not just people, but goods and other items, too.
So tell us, which Gemara are you learning? What are you learning? What was the most, let's share with us with some of your Torah that you're learning in Yeshiva. Which Gemara are you learning, number one? Which Talmud? The Talmud is, you're talking about, you want to share with us what you're learning with about the, what did you study today?
Well, today in Gemara class we learned about why women don't put on tefillin.
Okay.
And not just that topic specifically, but also goes along the lines of why women are exempt from
commandments which are bound by time.
Yes, time-bound positive commandments.
Positive commandments, right.
Yes. And it's understood that...
Well, women don't need... One of the things that people think that women and men have to all look alike and be like, women have a different channel, they're on a different frequency to connecting to God, that they don't need all the tefillin, to davening three times a day to be connected to God, whereas men need to have that
right.
constant setting to go to shul every morning and put on the tefillin. Because that's men and women are different frequencies.
Definitely, absolutely. We're much weaker than women.
I don't want to say one's weak. It's different channels.
Yes.
Different channels, and each one has their strengths. Men, for instance, have their strengths, women have their strengths. Each one is unique. And together they make up a unit, which in turn make up the Jewish people. But definitely the foundation of the Jewish people, and the Rebbe always spoke about this, the home, which is the essence of the Jewish nation, is run by the woman.
That's true.
And you know, that's why it's very important. That's one reason is also why we go according to the mother when it comes to Judaism. Because the mother is the foundation in terms of the Jewish nation. So you're taking this journey and you learned about in Hasidus. What did you learn in Hasidus?
Hasidus, we learned about actually Chabad, the acronym.
Right. Chochma Bina Das, which means every person is made up of 10 attributes.
Wisdom, understanding, knowledge. Right. I'm sure you can name the other 7.
Right. There's Chabad, which is Chochma Bina Das, which is wisdom, understanding, and knowledge. Wisdom is only a flash. Understanding is taking that initial idea and really intellectualize it, or bring it down into understanding, into the comprehension. And knowledge is actually implementing it. Which then comes, you know, when you think about God, the love of God, how you love God, then you develop the middle of Ava, which is love. Ava, Yira, fear, love, fear, and so on.
And that makes perfect sense, because I've loved God my whole life, but I just didn't know how to express that love. And so far I've come a long way, and I've definitely learned how to love God.
And God is
how to express that love, that is.
Right. How to express it into the physical world.
Exactly.
And the idea is that every single one of us, God is here for every single one of us. He tells us, you know, Kikore Velecha, I'll translate in a minute. Kikore Velecha Adobe Moed, Vifichach Bilbavcha Vasoso, which is based on the Tanya actually. Which means God, it's within everyone's reach to understand, to understand God both in your mind, your heart, and your actions. So you're able to implement all those things, both your intellect, your mind, which is the intellect, and which is understanding, the Chabad, and then the emotions, and then the actions. And it's Machshava Divrei Maaseh, which is every person has 3 garments, which is the intellect, and then the speech, and action. Some of us can control only our actions. Some are even wiser and able to control their speech. And if you're a really great tzaddik, then you're able to control your mind as well. To a certain extent, everyone's able to control your mind, because when something, a bad thought, or a thought of weakness or comes into a person, you're able to switch it by thinking something positive. That's why it's always good to have in your mind some Torah passages or a story, maybe a story from the Baal Shem Tov or the Alter Rebbe, just a story from a great tzaddik, just to be able to switch the channel, so to speak, in your mind. To be able to take it from, let's say, and switch the channel.
And I'll say right now, learning Hasidus is not really the easiest topic. It's, at least for me, I can say it was a little struggle learning Hasidus at first to try and wrap my mind around these concepts. It's just something I wasn't used to. But it was, once you do understand it, it's very powerful.
For instance, what was a little bit hard for
you? Well, first of all, talking about the 10 parts of Neshama.
Right.
First of all, how do you comprehend what Neshama? How do you comprehend what a
soul is? No, each one has his... It's made up of these 10 attributes. Each one has its ability to have wisdom, understanding, knowledge. Chochma Bina Das. Then you have Chesed Gvura Tikares, which is kindness, which is Ava, the severity, which is like Yira, the fear of God. And then, you know, actually in each one, you know, it says that each of the patriarchs, Abraham, for example, was the epitome of Chesed. He was the kindest person in the world. He used to give food for anyone. He used to give food and lodging to anyone. He had his tent, and the tent was open from all 4 sides. And then when they wanted to leave, they'd say, okay, either make a blessing, thank you one, or pay for it. So he was the epitome of Chesed. Yitzchok, Isaac, on the other hand, was the opposite. He was poor. He only gave if he deserved it. And Yaakov sort of made a combination, both of them. The idea of taking the best of both ends. It says Yaakov is Shapardas Avram. Anyways, but you know, the idea is it's not an easy concept. But
it's definitely difficult, but it's a great feeling once you finally can understand it.
You want to share with our audience about some of the jokes you heard from Rabbi Weinstein, or a joke or two, or maybe even a thought of being here in Brooklyn? Tell everyone has to, for those in Manhattan watching this TV show, it's only a subway ride away from Manhattan, the Crown Heights, Kingston Avenue. You take the number 3 train to Kingston Avenue, you get off, and you'll have the most interesting experience in the whole wide world.
Definitely interesting experience. And
it's only one subway token.
Yeah, there you go. And one train ride away.
One train, it's only 20 minutes by the train, and you come down Kingston Avenue, you come to 770, you can get the best kosher food over here.
Oh, plenty of kosher food.
And now we have kosher wisdom, food for your soul.
Exactly.
You know, food for your soul. You have to fill yourself up both physically and spiritually. And the way to fill yourself spiritually is you go to get a good piece of kugel or a good gefilte fish.
Or a nice slice of kosher Brooklyn pizza.
Oh, yeah. Or come and get some Torah.
Even better.
Torah is available. And it's always open. 770 Hadar Torah is on 824 Eastern Parkway. It's free. There's no admission. To walk in and to sit in with your... I come in here to teach the guys Torah every single day, you know?
I see you there every day.
Every day. I go in there to learn with the guys Torah. Why? Well,
and also to hunt them down and say, when are you going to be on my TV show?
That's it. The idea is...
How do you think I got here?
That's how he got here. The idea is Torah is the best... We don't charge for Torah. It's forbidden to charge for Torah because everyone, it's open for everyone. Jews, even non-Jews are welcome. Today I had a fellow from Benin, next to West Africa.
Okay.
And 2 weeks ago I had a fellow that came in from a city called Kuwait.
Okay.
He was born in Egypt.
Quite.
And he was actually a Muslim. And he came in, he contacted me through the website. And I said, you want to come, study, meet me, fine. Here's the address. Come over. So the idea is Torah for everyone, and everyone should take advantage. It's only a subway ride away. One token. There's no tokens anymore. There's one metro.
One metro card. $2.25. That's all it costs.
And you get to experience Torah and Mitzvahs and Mashiach now. That's why we're here. We want Mashiach now. That's the ultimate.
Absolutely.
When Mashiach comes, the whole world will realize it. Right now, the secret is in this. People listening to this show. But when Mashiach comes, everyone will realize it. The cat will be out of the bag.
We'll be able to hide it then.
Yeah. Listen, Chaim, I want to thank you.
Okay, thank you, Rabbi.
You know, for your time and for inspiration, teaching. And Mr. Hashem, please God, you'll pioneer, you'll become a great Torah scholar, Talmud Chacham. And don't, you know, keep on studying. Torah.
Okay.
Any other interesting you want to say? And off with any interesting jokes from Rabbi Weinstein?
Well, I do remember a good joke. I heard it again, he told me the first night, and then he told it again a week later. He, drinking some vodka, like, you know, the Chabads do with their Fabrigans.
Yeah.
And he says, you know, what is that you're holding in your hand? It's a cup. He says, what is this in Hebrew?
A cup.
A cup. He's like, well, the cup is not in the cup. Said, yeah, you gotta love cheesy wisdom like that. I said, okay, you know what? We'll make a deal. You stop telling that joke anymore this week, and I'll down this last thing of vodka, okay?
Baruch Hashem.
All right.
Shkoyah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Baruch Hashem 3 times, because it's chazokah. Chazokah means it's strong, you know, when someone is on a piece of land for 3 years, that's it, he owns it.
Or when we finish, he's talking to Torah.
You say chazak. Chazak, in this chazak. That's it. Shkoyah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
This week's parsha was Shabbos Chazak.
Oh, okay.
Chazak. We just had Chazak. We just started this week parsha Shmos. New book. Okay, thank you very much for watching.
Thank you.
Thank you.